Simon & Schuster Audio presents Bloody River Blues, a location scout mystery by Jeffery Deaver, writing as William Jeffries, read by Holter Graham.
All you need for a movie is a gun and a girl. Jean-Luc Godard. Chapter 1. All he wanted was a case of beer. And it looked like he was going to have to get it himself. The way Style explained it, I can't hardly get a case of Labatt's on the back of a Yamaha.
That's okay, Pellam said into the cellular phone.
You want a six-pack? I can handle that. But the rack's a little loose, which I guess I owe you. The rack, I mean. Sorry.
The motorcycle was the film company's, but had been issued to Pellam, who had in turn loaned it to Style. Style was a stuntman. Pellam chose not to speculate on what he had been doing when the rack got broken.
That's okay, Pellam said again. I'll pick up a case.
He hung up the phone. He got his brown bomber jacket from the front closet of the Winnebago, trying to remember where he'd seen the discount beverage store. The riverfront deli was not far away, but the date of his next expense check was, and Pellam did not feel inclined to pay $26.50 for a case, even if it had been imported all the way from Canada. He stepped into the kitchenette of the camper, stirred the chili, and put the cornbread in the small oven to heat. He had thought about cooking something else for a change. Nobody seemed to notice that whenever Pellam hosted the poker game, he made chili. Maybe he would serve it on hot dogs, maybe on rice, but it was always chili and oyster crackers. He didn't know how to cook much else. He thought about doing without the beer, calling back Style and saying, yeah, just bring a six-pack. But he did the calculation and decided they needed a whole case. There would be five of them playing for 6 hours, and that meant even a case would be stretched pretty thin. He would have to break out the mezcal and wild turkey as it was. Pellam stepped outside, locked the camper door, and walked along the road paralleling the gray plain of the Missouri River. It was just after dark, an autumn weekday, and by rights ought to be rush hour. But the road dipped and rose away from him, and it was deserted of traffic. He zipped his jacket tight. Pellam was tall and thin. Tonight he wore jeans and a work shirt that had been black and was now mottled gray. His cowboy boots sounded in loud, scraping taps on the wet asphalt. He wished he had worn his Lakers cap or his Stetson. A cold wind, salty, fishy-smelling, streamed off the river. His eyes stung. His ears ached. He walked quickly. He was worried that Danny, the scriptwriter of the movie they were now shooting, would show up early. Pellam had recently left a 10-pound catfish in Danny's hotel room bathtub, and the writer had threatened to weld the Winnebago door shut in retaliation. The fourth of the poker players was a grip from San Diego, who looked just like the merchant marine he had once been, complete with tattoo. The fifth was a lawyer in St. Louis, a hawkish man with jowls. The film company's L.A. office had hired him to negotiate property and talent contracts with the locals. He talked nonstop about Washington politics as if he had run for office and been defeated because he was the only honest candidate in the race. His chatter was a pain, but he was a hell of a good man to play poker with. He bet big and lost amiably. Hands in pockets, Pellam turned down Adams Street, away from the river, studying the spooky, abandoned red brick Maddox Ironworks building, thinking, it's damp. It may rain. Thinking, would the filming in this damn town go much over schedule? Would the chili burn? Had he turned it down? Thinking about a case of beer. All right, Gotti is walking down third, okay? He works most of the time till 6 or 6:30, but tonight he's going for drinks with some girl I don't know who she is. Philip Lombro asked Ralph Bales, why is he in Maddox? That's what I'm saying. He's going to the Jolly Rogue for drinks. You know it? Then he's going to Callahan's for the steak. As he listened, Philip Lombro dipped his head and touched his cheek with two fingers formed into a V. He had a long face, tanned. The color, though, didn't turn Lombro bronze. He was more silvery, like platinum, which matched his mane of white hair, carefully sprayed into place. He said, what about Gaudia's bodyguard? He won't be coming. Gaudia thinks Maddox is safe. Okay, then he's got a reservation at 7:30. It's a 5-minute walk. I timed it, and they'll leave at 7:45. Ralph Bales was sitting forward on the front seat of the navy blue Lincoln as he spoke to Lombro. Ralph Bales was 39, muscular, hairy everywhere but on the head. His face was disproportionately thick, as if he were wearing a latex special effects mask. He was not an ugly man, but seen straight on, his face, because of the fat, seemed moon-like. Tonight he wore a black and red striped rugby shirt, blue jeans, and a leather jacket. He's on 3rd, okay? There's an alleyway there going west. It's real dark. Stevie will be there doing kind of a homeless number. Homeless? They don't have homeless in Maddox. Well, a bum. They got bums in Maddox, Ralph Bales said. Okay. He's got a little Beretta, a .22. Doesn't even need a suppressor. I got the Ruger. Stevie calls him. He stops and turns. Stevie does him, up close. I'm behind just in case. Bang, we're in Stevie's car over the river. Then we're lost. I'll be in front of the alley then, Lombro said, on 3rd. Ralph Bales didn't say anything for a moment, but kept his eyes on Lombro. What he saw was this. A hook nose, kind eyes, trim suit, paisley tie. It was odd, but you couldn't see more than that. You thought you could peg him easily, as if the silver hair, the tasseled oxblood loafer's polished spit shine, and the battered Rolex were going to explain everything about Philip Lombro. But no, those were all you could come up with. The parts, and the parts alone, like a People magazine photo. Lombro, who was calmly looking back into Ralph Bales' eyes, said, yes? Do you have a problem with that? Ralph Bales decided he could win the staring contest if he wanted to, and began to examine the swirl of hair on the back of his own hand. Okay, I don't think it's such a good idea, you being there, but I told you that already. Yes, you did. Okay, I still don't think it's a good idea. I want to see him die. You'll see pictures. The Post-Dispatch will have pictures. The reporter will have pictures in color. I'll be there from 7:15. Ralph Bales was drumming his fingers on the leather seat of the Lincoln. It's my ass, too. Lombro looked at his watch. The crystal was chipped and yellowed. 6:50. I can find somebody else to do the job. Ralph Bales waited a moment. That won't be necessary. You want to be there? That's your business. Yes, it is my business. Without response, Ralph Bales swung the car door open. That's when it happened. Son of a bitch. A thud, the sound of glass on glass, a couple of muted pops. Ralph Bales saw the man, a thin guy in a brown leather jacket, standing there, looking down, a sour smile on his face, a smile that said, I knew something like this was going to happen. Foamy beer chugged out of the bottom of the cardboard case, which rested on its end on the sidewalk. The man looked at Ralph Bales, then passed him into the car. Ralph Bales slammed the door and walked away. The man with the rueful grin said, hey, my beer. Ralph Bales ignored him and continued along Adams. Hey, my beer. Ralph Bales ignored him. The man was stepping toward him. I'm talking to you, hey! Ralph Bales said, fuck you! And turned the corner. The tall man stood staring after him for a moment, his mouth twisted and indignant, then bent down and looked into the window of the Lincoln. He cupped his hands. He tapped on the window.
Hey, your buddy. Hey.
He rapped again. Lombro put the car in gear. It pulled away quickly. The man jumped back. He watched the Lincoln vanish. He knelt down to his wounded carton, which was pumping beer into the gutter like a leaky fire hydrant. Maddox Police Department Patrolman First Class Donald Buffett watched the last of the beer trickle into the street.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.